dear listener, to take us through today's Philothea program is Father George Kochalikal, the Spiritual Director of Philothea Missionaries. Welcome to the program.
Twenty-fifth Sunday of the year. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner going out at the daybreak to hire workers for his vineyard. He made an agreement with the workers for 1 denarius a day and sent them to his vineyard. Going out at about the third hour, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'Go to my vineyard too, and I will give you a fair wage.' So they went out. At about the sixth hour, and again at about the ninth hour, he went out and did the same. Then, at about the 11th hour, he went out and found more men standing around. And he said to them, 'Why have you been standing here idle all day?' 'Because no one has hired us,' they answered. He said to them, 'You go into my vineyard too.' In the evening, the owner of the vineyard said to his bailiff, 'Call the workers and pay their wages, starting with the last arrival and ending with the first.' So those who were hired at about the 11th hour came forward and received 1 denarius each. When the first came, they expected to get more, but they too received 1 denarius each. They took it, but grumbled at the landowner. 'The men who came last,' they said, 'have done only 1 hour, and you have treated them the same as us, though we have done a day's work in all the heat.' He answered one of them and said, 'My friend, I am not being unjust to you. Did we not agree 1 denarius? Take your earnings and go. I choose to pay the last comer as much as I pay you. Have I no right to do what I like with my own? Why be envious because I am generous? Thus, the last will be first, and the first last.' This is the Gospel of the Lord."
Why be envious because I am generous? Dear brothers and sisters, among the four Gospels, only that of Matthew narrates the parable of the laborers. When Jesus narrated the parable to the crowd in front of him, he had foremost in his mind the Pharisees in their midst, and the message he meant to convey to them was this: give up the wrong idea that God is calling only the Jewish people to be saved. God's heart is far larger than yours. You should be happy, not jealous, that God's plan is to save all peoples, all nations. But when, some 30 years later, Matthew put the parable into writing for communities of Jews who had become Christians, the message for them was somewhat different, but one, nevertheless, which Jesus had also very much in mind when narrating the parable. What was it? He was telling them, God invited you, and you have accepted his invitation to enter God's kingdom. Rejoice at it, but never forget that this has been an exquisite act of mercy on God's part. Neither you nor anyone else ever had any claim to form part of it. Now that you are in, go on happily working in the Lord's field, and see that you work in earnest, since your reward is assured and could not be greater, namely eternal life. The Holy Spirit inspired Matthew to write down the parable of the laborers the way he did, that it might help the Christian communities of all times. And the lesson it conveys applies to us as well. Let us now examine it in detail. The first and second reading we have heard complete the lesson which the parable teaches. The parable of the vineyard. There are very few vineyards in our region. Had Jesus preached in our midst, he would have spoken about laborers being called to work in a plantation or in a maize field or so. Now, at the time of Christ, most of the land in Palestine belonged to a few rich people. The rest depended for their livelihood on these few. They worked for them on a daily wage and would have their fill or go hungry for the day, depending on whether they would be hired or not to work in the fields. These were the people whom the Bible calls the poor of Yahweh, or the poor of the land, that is, people without land of their own. Needless to say that oftener than not, they were at the mercy of the rich. Now, laborers would gather early morning in the village square for landowners to come and hire them. The lucky ones followed the emperor to the fields. The normal salary was 1 denarius, the equivalent to the more or less of 3 shillings, of the old 3 shillings, but barely sufficient to provide a square meal for the worker and his family. Elderly people among us will remember that this was probably approximately the salary of a worker in Kenya, maybe 60 or 70 years ago. But something happens in the parable which did not take place in normal life. The normal practice was that those hired early morning went off to the work assigned to them, while the rest, without hope of being hired for that day, spent their time chatting around in the hope of being more lucky the next day. In the parable, instead, we see the landowner going back to the square time and again, at the 3rd, the 6th, the 9th, and even at the 11th hour. This way of counting hours calls for an explanation. People had no watches in those days. They counted time much as our ancestors did, guiding themselves by the sun. And for them, the first hour was the time going from sunrise to mid-morning. The 3rd hour lasted from mid-morning till noon. The 6th hour went from noon till about 3 in the afternoon. The 9th hour from 3 in the afternoon till sunset, similar to what we use when we speak in Kiswahili. Now the parable speaks of the 11th hour, that is about 5 in the evening, hardly an hour before sunset, when the last batch started work. The parable seems to speak of harvest time, the summer time, when the sun rises at about 6 and sets at 6 in the evening, which means that the first batch put in 12 hours of work, while the last one put in scarcely 1 hour. Of course, this did not happen in daily life, but Jesus narrated the parable that way to help people understand some important message, an important message. Now let us look at the theme on the pavement of wages. Both the book of Leviticus and the book of Deuteronomy commanded that people living on a daily wage be paid on the same day. The wage was the only way to obtain food for themselves and for their family. You can read it in the book of Leviticus chapter 19 verse 3 or Deuteronomy chapter 24 verse 15. In the parable, payment started with the ones that had started work last, the one who had come in at the 11th hour. Of course, they must have jumped for joy on receiving a full denarius, as if they had worked the whole day. The generosity of the landowner towards those who started work late in the day raised to the hopes of a higher wage in those who had been hired first, and provoked their anger on receiving the same pay as the others, the denarius they had agreed to for a day's work. their reaction was sheer jealousy. Had the latecomers not been called to work, they would have gone home happy with their denarius. They would have been equally satisfied if the latecomers had received less pay, let us say by 75 cents or 50 or 25 cents less, according to the number of hours of work they had put in. So the landowner made them see how unreasonable they were. He made them see that they had no reason to complain. And that way, Jesus was teaching a lesson to the Jews. As we pointed out at the beginning of our reflection, Jesus meant to include a double lesson in the parable. The first for the Jews listening to him, and the second for the Christians of all times, who would one day listen to the parable as narrated by Matthew. Obviously, the laborers who started work at the normal time represented the Jews to whom the good news was announced first. They were the first to be invited to enter the kingdom. The various groups of laborers called at various times during the day represented the non-Jews, the pagans. They were invited and are still being invited at various times in history to enter God's kingdom. The Jews had no right to complain that God called also the non-Jews. In fact, all nations were called to walk in his king vineyard. They should have been happy rather than jealous about it. Again, they should have been happy that the reward the non-Jews received was the same as theirs, a full denarius. It was an overgenerous wage, both for them and for the pagans, a reward far exceedingly any service man could enter in God's kingdom. The full denarius stands for eternal life. So that was the lesson for the Jews. Now, for the pagans, for the Christians, the parable of the laborers contains not one but several lessons for the non-Jews. That is, for us all, the latecomers, whom Jesus invited out of sheer love to enter his kingdom and work in his field. What are some of these lessons? The first lesson is this: to have been called into God's kingdom is a sheer act of mercy on God's part. To start with, none of us deserved being called. Those among us who became Christians later in life are well aware that we did not accept God's invitation as quickly as we should have done. And those among us who were baptized soon after birth as children of Christian parents should remember that the invitation to walk in God's field is renewed day after day, that often we refuse to go, and Christ has to plead with us to go and start work. We often prefer to loaf about wasting our life, going spiritually hungry, rather than work in his kingdom, in his vineyard as we ought. A second lesson: God is extremely generous with his reward. He does not wait till the evening of our life to reward us. We are being rewarded already as we go on working. God's gifts have already far exceeded whatever we have done in his service. The mere fact of being at God's service is a reward in itself. And a final lesson: when evening time comes, that is at our death, we shall receive a denarius, a full reward, that is eternal life. The fact that the wage is so great clearly proves that the landowner loves us far more than we can imagine. And this should urge us to go on working in earnest at God's service. But there is also another important point we must bear in mind. Let us not delude ourselves. Only those who work in earnest in God's field will be rewarded. This the parable does not say, but one thing is certain: when the evening of our life comes, we shall receive either a full denarius or nothing. Rather, the wage for the faithful worker will be eternal life, and for the lazy, eternal death. The second reading of this Sunday is taken from the letter of Paul to the Christians of a town called Philippi. It was a community very dear to Paul for its faithfulness to Christian life. Paul wrote his letter from prison, among other reasons, in order to thank them for the help they had provided him with. In this passage that we read, Paul opens his heart to his beloved Christians to tell them how he was being pulled in two directions. He tells them that on the one hand, he longed to go on preaching the gospel, serving Christ in his Christians, bringing more and more people into God's kingdom. But on the other hand, he longed for the day when he would be with Christ forever in heaven. He longed to be with his master, yet he was reluctant to leave his Christians behind. They still needed him. Paul comes out of his indecision by inviting his Christians and himself to greater faithfulness to Christ in life. He tells them, avoid anything in your daily life that would be unworthy of the gospel of Christ. Avoid anything in your daily life that would be unworthy of the gospel of Christ. Paul considered himself totally unworthy of being in God's kingdom, unworthy also of preaching the good news. He was extremely grateful to Christ for having called him into his service. He felt also unworthy of the reward that awaited him in heaven, yet longed for it, since he knew that his reward was not just something, but someone, a person, Christ himself. Dear brothers and sisters, Paul is the perfect model for us all as to how to live in God's kingdom and work in God's field. We must go on with the task entrusted to us by God in life, with all humility and full of gratitude, working in earnest, as faithful workers do, and always filled with the joyful hope that in the evening of our life, Christ will willingly offer himself to us as our eternal reward. We shall see him as he is. The best conclusion to this Sunday's reflection is Paul's words to the Christians of Philippi, words which are engraved in Paul's tomb in Rome. For me, to live means just one thing, Christ, while death will bring me a fabulous gain. For me, to live means just one thing, Christ, while death will bring me a fabulous gain. Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. That is, let Christ and his gospel be the center of all that we do or say in life. That makes a Christian long for, rather than fear death, since death is just a door leading us into Christ, into everlasting life. And so we pray. Father, we thank you for having called us to work in your kingdom. Fill our hearts with joy at the thought that we are at your service. Keep us faithful till the evening of our life, when you will be our reward in heaven. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
My Lord, to my heart, give
Following the spirituality of St. Francis de Sales, Philothea missionaries are consecrated Catholic laywomen and men ministers serving the Church in the ministries specifically for the formation of the Catholic laity. They are involved in family pastoral ministry for the married and single families, youth pastoral ministry for youth in parishes, schools, and colleges, pastoral ministry to the sick for those in the hospitals and clinics, ministry to the professionals for medics, lawyers, teachers, and journalists, and catechetical ministry for the formation of catechists and Sunday school teachers. Philothea missionaries offer retreat programs on every first and last Saturdays of the month at St. Francis de Sales Family Center at Kiserian. For more information, call 20-16888 or 0725-075-566 or 0722-798-710.